Showing list of data to a user is one of the most common UI patterns. When working with large datasets, you can improve app performance and reduce memory usage by fetching and displaying data asynchronously in chunks. This also allows your app to support infinite datasets. And if you're pulling down network data, you probably want a local cache as well. This gets complicated fast, but Android Jetpack Paging 3.0 can help. In this video, we'll be integrating the paging library into the data layer of an existing app, a GitHub repository search app. While doing that, you'll also learn about the basic components of paging. The app in its current form follows the Jetpack architecture guidelines with a repository responsible for fetching the data we want to display. A view model transforms the data from the repository into a form consumable by the UI. The UI displays the transformed data from the API. You may have noticed, however, there's quite a bit of code required to transform the data from where it's fetched to where it's consumed in the UI. It has to keep track of lots of manual, mutable state across a few layers of the app. And this is a fairly generic requirement that can be abstracted out for reuse, and this is exactly where Paging 3.0 comes in. The Jetpack Paging library provides a convenient way of pulling ordered data sets from your data layer into your business layer while offering transformations, caching, and other niceties for easy consumptions in your UI. Let's get started. The first thing we need to do is define how we actually fetch data. Currently, our app does this in the repository using the GitHub service. In the context of the paging library, this functionality is implemented with a type called the paging source. Specifically, the paging source defines how to fetch and refresh data around existing boundaries defined by existing data. Okay, let's implement it. Since we're pulling data from the GitHub API, an app name for this in the app is GitHub Paging Source. To build it, we need to define the following: the type of paging key. In our case, the GitHub API uses one-based index numbers for pages, so the type is an int. The type of data loaded. In our case, we're loading repo items, where the data retrieved is coming from the GitHub service. A data source will be specific to a certain query, so we need to make sure that we're also passing the query information to the GitHub service. With the shell of the GitHub paging source defined, we can now implement the methods to enable us to load our data. There are two main methods to provide implementations for: load and get refresh key. Let's start with the load method. The load function will be called by the paging library to asynchronously fetch more data to be displayed as the user scrolls around. The loadParams object keeps information related to the load operation, including the following: the key of the first page to be loaded. If this is the first time the load is called, params key will be null. In this case, you will have to define the initial page key. Load size, the requested number of items to load. The load function returns a load result. It can either be a loadResults.page if the result was successful, or loadResult.error in case of an error. When constructing the loadResult page, pass null for the next key or the previous key if the load cannot be loaded in the corresponding direction. For example, in our case, we could consider that if the network response was successful, but the list was empty, we do not have any more data to be loaded. So in that case, the next key can be null. Note that by default, the initial load size is 3 times the page size. This ensures that the first time the list is loaded, the user will see enough items without triggering too many network requests, if the user does not scroll past what's loaded. This is also something to consider when computing the next key in the paging source implementation. Next, we need to implement getRefreshKey. The refresh key is used for subsequent refresh calls to pagingSource.load. The first call is the initial load, which uses the initial key provided by the pager. A refresh happens whenever the paging library wants to load new data to replace the current list. For example, on swipe to refresh or on invalidation, due to database updates, configuration changes, process death, etc. Typically, subsequent refresh calls will want to restart loading data centered around pagingState.anchorPosition, which represents the most recently accessed index. With the paging source defined, we can now create a pager. A pager is a class that is responsible for incrementally pulling chunks of data from the paging source as requested by the UI. We'll be creating our pager in our repository class as it has reference to types we need to create our GitHub paging source. Creating the pager is simple enough. The first thing we need is a paging config, which defines basic parameters that govern how the pager will fetch data. There are quite a few configuration options here, but for this particular case, we're concerned with just two. The page size, the number of items to be loaded at once from the paging source, and enable placeholders, whether the paging data returns null for items that have not been loaded yet. We typically want the page size to be large enough, at least enough to fill the visible area of the screen, but preferably 2 to 3 times that, so the pager doesn't have to keep fetching data over and over again to show enough material on the screen as the user scrolls. With the pager constructed, we cannot get data from it. The type produced from the pager is the paging data. The paging library offers multiple ways of consuming paging data as a stream, including Kotlin flow via pager.flow, live data via pager.livedata, RxJava flowable via pager.flowable, RxJava observable via pager.observable. Each emission of paging data is a distinct window into its backend paging source. As a user scrolls through the list, the paging data will keep fetching from the paging source to provide content. Should the paging source be invalidated, a new paging data will be emitted to make sure the items being paginated through are in sync with what is displayed in the UI. It may help to think of paging data as a stream of events from the paging source as an instance in time. This stream of paging data is what the business layer can then opt to transform before presenting it to the UI. That's it for this episode. So far, we've covered what a paging source is, an implemented one, defined a paging config and used it to create a pager, exposed a stream of paging data from the pager. Stay tuned to see how to consume paging data in the UI and populate our list of repos.